Hello everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So in this video, I'm going to talk about two most important reports that have been recently released. First one is World Migration Report, then the next one is State of Food and Agriculture Report. But this session is not restricted to these two reports only. I have other questions as well for you. For example, we have the first state in India that has launched the Cyber Tehsils. So what is this? That is something we are going to talk about in this video along with some other questions. So let's begin this video quickly. But before that, the information for you all is that this PDF is downloadable. You can download it from the Telegram group's link, which is in description. Okay. Now let's begin with our first question. Which of the following statements are not true about the World Migration Report 2022? However, this is very anomalous. I also find it very unique or intriguing that why do they have named this report as World Migration Report 2022 when they are analyzing the data of 2020. But that is something that we should ignore. Now let's read out the options. So option A says around 281 million people migrated in the world in 2020, which is equanimous to 3.6% of the global population. The report is published by the UNDP with Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative. In 2020, US$702 billion worth of remittances were in circulation. Climate change has displaced more people than conflicts internally. Okay, none of the above is the option E. So guys, here the right answer is option B, because this report has not been released by the UNDP with Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative. Okay, rather it has been released by the International Organization for Migrants. So that is the UN organization, that is also a UN specialized organization that has released this report. Now, these two organizations release a very, very important report. So guys, can you tell me that which report is released by UNDP in collaboration with Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative? Bahut important report hai from the exam point of view. And on the same lines of that report, Niti Aayog has recently released our own indigenous version of that report. I hope that you are guessing, you are gaining what I'm trying to say. So name that report in the comment section below, which is released by these two organizations collectively. Now here, there is a small correction that you all need to pay attention to, and that correction is that 281 people, migrants were there in the world, okay? So the total number of migrants in 2020 was around 281. Okay, not that ki 281 people have migrated within a single year of 2020. No, that's not the thing. The correction here is this. Now you don't have to worry about it, because I will correct the PDF and then you will then that PDF will be provided to you. Okay. Now let's discuss this report in detail. The very first and the very crude fact about this report is that it's the 11th edition of this report, and as the name says, that this report assesses the data on migration. Now this report has many facts, so I have divided and classified those facts in three categories. One category talks about the international migration. Next category, category two, talks about the remittances that we receive from our migrants that are residing in other countries. And the third part talks about the internal displacement. Okay, so this is, in this manner, I have divided this report in three parts. And now let's discuss those three parts one by one. So the very first part here talks about the international migration. So as I have told you that 281 million people were migrants, not migrated in 2020. So again, I'm saying that this will be corrected. Now, these many people were the migrants in 2020, which is equivalent to 3.6% of the global population. Top five highest international migrant population countries, basically the countries which have the largest amount of migrants in other countries. Okay, so India has 18 million people. So 18 million people of Indian origin are residing in other countries. This reminds me a very recent development that has taken place. the new CEO of Twitter. Can you guys name him in the comment section below? So with the appointment of that person as the head of Twitter, there was a there was a flood of news that now many international organizations are being led by the Indians. So in the wake of that only, I'm going to ask you this question. Do mention it in the comment section below. So 18 million people. So India has the highest number of people residing in other countries. Okay. Indian origin people are the highest in number, we can say. Next is Mexico, Russia, China, Syrian Arab Republic. Now you don't have to memorize the population of all these countries. Only India's population would do wonders for you. Top five destinations for international migrants. So USA, Germany, Saudi Arabia, Russia, UK. So again, you can memorize the countries in rank wise and memorize the top one, the number of migrants attracted by the top country, that is USA. Okay. Now the second part is about the remittances. Obviously, people working in the other country would send money back to their families in their own countries. And whenever we talk about remittance, we always need to keep this thing in our mind that remittances are a major source of income for low and middle income countries. In some countries, which are at the very bottom strata, for them, the remittances are even more than the FDI or the overseas development assistance that they receive. So remittances play a very important role when it comes to low and middle income countries, and India is one country that receives the highest amount of remittance. So in light of that, we need to pay attention to the remittance data. Okay. So in 2020, $702 billion worth of remittances were in circulation. However, this amount is lower than the amount that was there in 2019. This is clearly from the impact of the COVID pandemic. Okay. So in 2019, $719 billion amount was in circulation, which has been reduced to $702 billion. Remittances flow to low and middle income countries was reduced to $540 billion in 2020 from $548 billion in 2019. Top five remittance receiving countries. So here you can see the data year wise. Okay. So we have to pay attention to the data of 2020. So India received $83.15 billion of remittances in 2020. Then China is at number two, Mexico, Philippines, Egypt. So these are the top five countries in terms of remittance receivers. Then we have remittance sending countries. So USA again is the top country here, obviously the country which is attracting the major amount of migrants. The most amount of migrants would be the one which would be sending the most amount of remittances out. So obviously US is the first. Then at the second number, we have UAE. Third number pe, we have Saudi Arabia, then Switzerland, and then Germany. Now, this is the third part of the report, which talks about the internal displacements. Okay. So international migration is one, we can say it has a very positive connotation because it denotes how capable the people of a country are, that they are working in other country. Particularly, we can take it in the light of India, okay, in the context of India, where many Indians are going out and they are leading the major organizations of the world right now. So international migration has a very positive connotation, we can say, except for the brain drain concept that we have in place. But however, that is also eluding right now. Next is internal displacement. So internal displacement has a very negative connotation. Within the country, the people are migrating from one place to another place. And why would the people migrate from one place to other place within their own country? Either because there are no jobs, or there is conflict or violence kind of situation, instability is there, or there are natural disasters. So all of these three are the very negative reasons for migration. Therefore, I told you that international migration has a bit positive connotation in comparison to internal displacement. So by the end of 2020, we had 40.5 million people who were internally displaced. Okay. And these 40.5 million people were the new displacements. Okay, new people. So within 1 year of 2020, 40.5 million people were displaced. Causes of internal displacement, climate change and conflict. But climate change was a major reason, was more great of a reason than the conflict for people to migrate. 76% of the 40.5 million people, that is 30.7 million people, were displaced due to disasters. 24% left their places due to violence. Storms in natural disasters only, storms accounted for 14.6 million of displacements, and floods accounted for 14.1 million displacements. Philippines had the highest absolute number of people who were migrating in 2020 because of the natural disasters. So do remember Philippines, okay? Now let's move on to the second report. Which of the following organizations has released the State of Food and Agriculture 2021 report? So we have FAO, that is Food and Agriculture Organization, UNCTAD, UNIDO, United Nations Industrial Development Organization, IFAD, WFP. Okay, so which one is the right answer? The right answer is FAO. Now this report primarily talks about the agri-food systems. Okay, now what is agri-food system? Let me give you a brief about it. So agri-food system is basically the entire global food chain that includes the agriculture produce, then your livestock, then your fisheries, aquaculture. So we have agriculture, crops and auxiliary services. Both of these are included. So this report says that even though we had COVID-19, even in the situation of COVID-19, the agri-food systems supply chain has shown resilience, but there is a need to improve it, because if we face another shock and that shock would lead to the decrease in income in the people in countries, then obviously majority of the people, approximately 1 billion people, would not be able to get their access to healthy diets. I hope that you are understanding this point. Even though you are not understanding this point at this point of time, I'm going to teach you it when we cover this report thoroughly, okay? So let's first have a look at the first statement, that is saying this report has been released by FAO. The report focuses on the need to make supply chain more resilient to shock and stresses to ensure availability and access of food by people. Although agri-chain food supply chains have shown resilience in the face of the COVID pandemic, actions are required to make it more resilient, to make it more sustainable, climate friendly and affordable. Now, why do we need to do work in this dimension? Because globally, some 3 billion people cannot afford a healthy diet, one that protects the people against malnutrition. This is a very huge number. 3 billion people are not able to have access to healthy diet, okay? Now, as per FAO, if a shock reduced the income of people in 143 countries by one third, a healthy diet would be beyond the financial reach of an additional 1 billion people, okay? So what this point is saying, that if there is another shock like COVID pandemic, which results into the decrease in the economy or in the income of the people, then there would be additional 1 billion people who would not be able to get access, who would not be able to have healthy diets. And these 1 billion people would majorly come from the middle income countries. Okay, because low income countries, there is already a lot of people who are not able to have access to the healthy diets. So here, this additional 1 billion people burden would be on the middle income countries. Okay. Now in low income countries, this shock would translate into a deficit in availability of energy sufficient food for a large amount of people. Okay. So in middle income countries, there might be chances that the people would not be able to have the healthy diets. But in low-income countries, if this shocks occurs, then the low-income country people would not be able to have sufficient diet also that would give them energy for the work of a day. So that is the meaning of this point. And this is the meaning of agri-food system. So clearly you can see that this report has very generic points that you can use in your descriptive answers if you're talking about the sustainability of the agriculture and the resilience of global food supply chains. Next question is, which has become the first state to create cyber tehsils? The right answer here is Madhya Pradesh. Now guys, what are tehsils? Tehsils are the administrative units of a district, basically the government offices that keeps the land records and also collects land revenue. Okay, so they basically supervises the patwaris, and though patwaris do this work. Okay, so Madhya Pradesh has become the first state in the country to do this work, to have cyber tehsils. Now all the people of the state can access the land records and other services offered by the tehsils via online platform. Madhya Pradesh government has also launched the Urja Saksharta Abhiyan, and again it became the first state to do so. Now what is this Urja Saksharta Abhiyan? Urja means energy, Saksharta means literacy, Abhiyan means campaign. So energy literacy campaign. Now under this campaign, basically the government of Madhya Pradesh would create awareness among the people to use energy efficiently. Okay, that is the basic idea behind launching this campaign. Next question is, when did the Department of Pension launched Bhavishya online platform in all central ministries and departments for processing pension cases? The right answer is 2017. Now this platform is in the news because the Ministry of Personnel has recently launched the facility of face recognition, okay, online face recognition for the pensioners. So pensioners are required to submit their life certificates annually to the Department of Pension, to this Ministry of Personnel, so that they can ensure that the person we are paying pension to is alive, okay, and is only receiving this pension. So now, in order to make it easier and accessible for the people, for the pensioners, they have launched this unique face recognition technology. So now by sitting at their homes only, they can just do this work. In light of this news, because this is the news, this Bhavishya portal has been asked from you. So this Bhavishya portal was launched in 2017 by the central government so that all the pension related work in different central ministries or departments can be processed online via this Bhavishya portal, and there should be no delay in processing the pension cases in any department just because the departments were not able to process them online through this platform. So there was a hurry by the central government. Central government mandated the departments and the ministries to quickly transition to this platform so that there would be no delay in the processing of pension cases. So 2017 is the year in which Bhavishya portal was launched. Next question is, which state has launched the microfinance incentive and relief scheme 2021 for rolling out the microfinance loan waiver scheme to give relief to 24 lakh women in the state? The right answer here is Assam. Nothing is there to be discussed. It's just a loan waiver scheme for the women of the state. Who has been elected as the first woman president of the Indian Mountaineering Foundation? Harshvanti Bhisht is the right answer. Which film received the Best Film Award at the BRICS Film Festival 2021? So guys, here the right answer is option D, Barakat and The Sun Above Me Never Sets. Both of these movies have got this award. Now related to this festival, you need to know one or two facts that are important. First one is that it's the sixth edition of this festival. Next point here is that it was the first time that this festival was organized alongside the International Film Festival of India. 52nd International Film Festival of India, which was held in Goa. Okay, so it was the first time that this festival was organized alongside this IFFI. Okay, and this basically festival aims to showcase the movies of the BRICS nation countries. Now let's move on to the awards. So Best Film Award has been given to the South African film Barakat, which is directed by Emmy Jabta, and Russian film The Sun Above Me Never Sets has been directed by this person. You can very well ignore the directors here, because again, I would say that would be too much of a depth for the examiner to ask questions from the directors of these movies. I think that the country of origin and the name of the movie would suffice your preparation for the phase one of our BSLB award. Best Director Award has been given to Brazilian filmmaker Lucia Murad for her movie Anna. Best Actor Male has been given to Dhanush for his role in Asuran. Now there are high chances that a question is made from this award. Okay, Dhanush for this movie Asuran. Best Actress Female, Brazilian actress Lara Balderoni for her film On Wheels. Okay, so guys, here this video ends. I hope that you have liked the content provided by us, and if you understand the content and like it, then do not forget to subscribe this channel, share this video and like it. Thank you so much.